Thank you guys for waking up early, joining us. Let's see. Okay, that's me. My hair is a little longer than. Actually, that's a Hermione wig from the real Harry Potter. They were throwing it away, so I took it. You'll see a theme. I'm a co-founder and I guess CEO. I never call myself that, but mostly a director at the company. And then there's Dan also.
That's my real hair though, it's not a wig.
With his real hair. Slash a wig. He had to be a stand-in for a project, and we were too embarrassed to have a bald man do it. So yeah. No shame, Dan.
I feel it.
But that's our, I don't know, they're just silly pictures I found. They're my LinkedIn pictures. And Dan heads up strategy at our company in regards to our mission. So to give you a quick kind of one or two line of our company, we're a full-service film company. But we use our work to train men and women coming out of homelessness or incarceration on our jobs. And so Dan has led that force in terms of teaching. We all teach and coach at different levels, but also how to integrate that into jobs that can be quite difficult. So Dan has headed that up. And so just to kick us off, we're a film company, so I figured I should show you some of our work. This project in particular, we shot last year with Nike. Part of a campaign, a social media campaign they were doing to promote, what are they doing? Oh, they wanted people to run with their friends in creative places. So you would run with your friend, you know, in an open field, take a picture and hashtag it, run free. And so this was a kickoff video that, I don't know how they used it, I never really know, but they paid us to make it and it was awesome. We got to travel. And so here it is. TV commercials to we do Instagram videos, so which is crazy that you pay us to do 15 second videos that like are there for 5 seconds. But anyway, so kind of with the regards to the theme of second chances, when Josh approached me, obviously with the mission of our company, it seemed fitting. But kind of a gloss over on the whole talk we're about to give is I feel like a lot of us. Even besides the men and women that have come through our company as apprentices, is their title. A lot of us have been given second chances in the company, whether it's professionally or even emotionally. We really do have a culture that believes in what we call like grace to each other, realizing we're all really messed up people and get to come together every day and work on weird stuff like this. So how I got here, that's me with, I used to have a parking spot at Universal. And I took that picture the day that I quit my job in LA because I figured I would never have a parking space again with my name. And I was like, it's just so cool. But so the journey started for me. I worked for 5.5 years with a film producer as his assistant. And it's what originally actually brought me to Philadelphia for the first time. I worked with filmmaker M. Night Shyamalan, which you're probably familiar with from all his amazing movies he's done. So I came here to actually work on the movie The Last Airbender, and I was in Philadelphia for 2.5 years, and that was my introduction into the city. I had never been here. I never really even thought about Philly before, but I was really struck at the time when I got here that, you know, I guess the best way for me to explain this, I was trying to think of it. For me, my whole journey to Philly to eventually coming back had a lot to do with a faith journey for me. So kind of go on this ride for me, because I know it's like inappropriate to talk religion or whatever in business. But for me, I became a Christian when I was in Philadelphia. And to me, I was very like childlike, and I was like, okay, what does that mean? So yeah. I started reading a Bible, and I was like, I'm gonna just ignore all the terrible crap that I've heard or seen, and I'm just gonna read it for myself. And something that, thank you, amen, that's right.
I like that.
I like this, all right. So what seemed like pretty straightforward to me is that Jesus really loved the poor, and he even said he was in the poor. And it felt very magical and ridiculous to me, but I was like, you know what, I'm gonna actually give this a chance, so to speak. And so I started investing in relationships with people living on the streets, and started to see patterns of incarceration or generational poverty. And I can only say that my desires really did start to change in what I cared for. And so while I was working, there's me working. Sorry. I found these like ridiculous photos while I was like, that's me at my desk. So this is a picture of me and one of the first friends I ever met on the street, Doug, who's actually still a really close friend of mine. And we used to host these barbecues at my house when I was living in Philadelphia. Where we would have friends of ours from the street just come to our house, and we'd have food together. And then I'd also have people that I worked with professionally come over to the barbecue. And at first they were like, this is really weird. That guy is homeless, right? Like, why is he here? And it was really, to me, like, started to be the formation of what the company is now, where I saw these two worlds of people that, based on their circumstances, were really separating them. And so it kind of started with us just really like partying together, minus the drinking, because that could get a little weird. And
yeah.
Some people struggle with drinking. So there's Doug, Sparkler. She's also homeless. You might actually see her in the city. She's like really involved in a lot of great things, and she always dresses really awesome. You should go introduce yourself to her though. She's a very, very sweet lady. Fortunately, these are the only pictures I found to like represent this time of my life, but I'm glad I took them. So then this picture will make sense in a second, but the whole time I'm working in Philadelphia, and I started to think, man, I was probably working 10 to 12 hours a day like a dog, and you have to understand, this was like my dream job. I loved everything about what I was learning. My boss pretty much taught me everything I know how to do now, even how to run a company. But something that he taught me was, when he hired me, is he said, my goal is for you to have, for you to do 40% of my work. There's gonna be assistants that can get me coffee and do my dry cleaning, but I want you to be able to do 40% of my job so that I can go home earlier and be with my family. And so the way that he always trained me was like real life on the job, you know, you gotta get it done because the studio doesn't care who you are, I just need to get the work done. And so when I started to think about my new desires with these friends of mine that are like Doug and Sparkler, they're living on the street, I was thinking, man, if I could teach them the business side of filmmaking, this could be a really restorative measure for them in their life. And so as I started to go down thinking through that, it's kind of started to be the genesis of what Neighborhood Film Company is now. It's important to realize we don't really train people to be directors or editors. We're using just the business side, which is, you know, vendor relations, putting agreements together, coordination, the million mechanical things that go into it. Very few people get to do the like sexy camera holding. We don't train that. But this actually, so when I finally quit my job and I gave up my cool little parking sign, Anders, the other co-founder who couldn't be here today, we moved into a shelter here in the city with Project Home. They're our first nonprofit partner. If you know who Sister Mary Scullion is, she's a really powerful figure here advocating for the poor. And she helped kind of build this idea with us. And she was the first person that told me I wasn't insane. And when I started talking about my faith in God, people thought I was nuts, which maybe I still am, I don't know. But yes, it is a good nut. Thank you, amen. But we moved into basically a dorm, as we called it. That's literally me standing on the furthest side of the wall. So it was pretty tight. So as you can imagine, I had some insane bouts with anxiety. Here's a shot, actually. So our first real client that we got, which was amazing, was Anthropologie, the women's clothing line. And we pitched for the work. They had no idea who we were. They picked us. But we had to do all the work. We didn't have an office, anything. So we did all the work from this bedroom that Anders and I shared. And I found this video when I was trying to put this deck together of, well, it'll speak for itself. So.
That's my desk. Anders' bed.
It's the editing suite number one.
Anders' desk.
Number two.
Little does Anthropologie know that we cut all their films from a dorm room.
It always sucked when Ricky was working late and I just wanted to go to bed because I couldn't. Because his shit is on my bed all the time.
Soon enough, that will be over.
It's a sacrifice, though, you know? This stuff makes it fun. Then it makes you appreciate whatever we have to come, all of them.
So that is a little glimpse at our life for the first 6 months. I actually slept on the floor. He slept on the bed. And then we would prop the mattress up, and then that was my desk. And I mean, we literally worked back to back for 6 months. And when we got the job, Anthropologie was like, yeah, we'll come to your office and we'll like go over all this stuff. And I was like, I don't know if that's a good idea. So we actually, our producer, Chris, who's still our producer now, his parents actually let us use their house while they're on vacation. And I told him it was like a social network vibe, you know, we're like building our space. I totally lied, because I was like, there's no way I was going to have him come to the shelter, because as much as I loved it, would have been very weird and tight. So, but now, to kind of give you a glimpse of where we've gone as a company, I have some pictures of our current office, which is really a privilege to have. It's a 6,000 square foot production space. Here's a shot. Sorry, they're a little grainy. Pictures don't look as good off of Instagram as you think. They need to be like that big. So this is a picture kind of staring down our space. There's like a little common area there. There's offices in the back. This is a cool little overhead shot in what we call the living room. It's one of our editors there, Dom, doing something creative. He's also an amazing writer. I'm sure that's what he's brewing up, some special there. This is our producer's office, doing what producers do, which is just sit back, watch everything come together. And then we have a sound space. So we have a composer in our office. His name is David Decker. It's my little plug for him because he's amazing. And he has one of the cooler offices too. He's got these cool pipes and stuff. It's an old brewery, so we kind of kept all the infrastructure.
Where is it?
It's in Brewery Town. Yes. It's a third story of this. It looks totally abandoned. We call it the speakeasy because most clients, when they come there, think they're going to like, this is like their perfect murder or something. And so this is one of our post suites. That's us editing very, very late last week to finish a job. So at least it's comfortable. Okay, so then I'm going to let Dan speak a little bit now, but the way that what started to happen within the first 6 months of us working, the business side was going really well, but we realized we were terrible at training people. And you know, our heart has always been to not just what the politically correct way to say this is. I just feel like there's a lot of training programs out there that don't really train people. My heart was, which really stemmed from my faith, is that when I looked at the way like Jesus looked at people, is he believed in them as much as he would believe in someone that was qualified. And so I believed that these people that were friends of mine could have the same capacity as someone like myself who was afforded an education or the, you know, support of a family and friends and coaches. If you think of all the people that have like probably helped you be in whatever position you are here today. And so I didn't want to do like a, oh, it's a week long resume building class and good luck. Cause there's the truth is those people will never compete against me in a real working world. And so I was like, is there a bridge then for us to do that? And so when Dan came on is when we really started to put some nuts and bolts to how could we take someone who's formerly incarcerated, formerly on the street, maybe no education, actually put them in a position to be competitive in the working world, not even just the film world, just the working world in general. Was that even possible? So there you go, Dan. Oh, that's awesome. Our cool logo for our training that is run under a nonprofit. So, and then this is a really cool quote that we always refer to in some of our manuals. More powerful than the mighty armies is an idea whose time has come. I don't know.
Victor Hugo.
I just really like that quote. So. Don't worry, you don't have to read this. It turned out really strange, but yeah. It's just a good backdrop. So
yeah, ahead, and a lot of the stuff that we'll show you don't have to feel like you need to read. If you can indulge me a little bit, I know you probably didn't come to hear about the state of nonprofits in Philadelphia, but it does give a good kind of backdrop of why we do the training the way that we do. So I'll try to be as concise as possible. I think two areas that we really saw current, like what's called workforce development, failing in many ways, and Ricky already kind of addressed, and failing to give a true second chance rather than the appearance of a second chance, was one, the actual training itself, in the sense that, as Ricky mentioned, more of what you see is because people are more concerned about headcount, so how many people can we get to the door? They tend to lower the bar and make what the training is not really training, it's more like a workshop that lasts a week or two, interview skills, and a resume building class, which, as most of you know, in terms of getting a job or starting a career, not just getting a job, but actually starting a career, takes far more than that. It takes time with professionals to learn hands-on skills, and both hard and applied. So we knew we wanted to actually make it something more developed. So our apprenticeship is actually 8 months long, and it's paid. The whole idea is, and even 8 months to us sometimes feels short. Honestly, I wish we could do like 2 years. But it's that was the first thing we really knew. This has to be long. We have to have these guys have the opportunity to learn things, but then actually apply them. And then the other thing that we saw is what we call family ratios, which is a lot of workforce development programs, they have like one social worker and like 50 clients that they're trying to serve. And so when you have those terrible ratios, all you can really give is like a once a month meeting, or at best maybe once every 2 weeks. And so we wanted to flip that and have a very small number of apprentices and a ton of people investing in them. So that's why we only train 3 at a time for the 8 months. And then have everyone who's involved in our network kind of build into them. The training itself, if you want to show the, again, you do not need to read all this.
Dan's going to read that verbatim here.
Phase one.
Yeah.
Skills.
I guess if anything, just blur it, like you can blur your eyes. You don't have to look at it, but it gives you at least a sense of the scope of skills, how the curriculum is built. And I'm sure some of you who are in college or went to college wish that universities did it this way, but the whole idea, so my background's in teaching, which is very exciting building this curriculum, because I got to say, I have no board, I'm gonna have a nonprofit board, but they'll let me do what I want, but I don't have an education board, I don't have administration telling me what my requirements are to teach, so I can basically build out, what do you have to learn to succeed in the working world, right? So nothing should be taught in the classroom in this first phase that they're in that isn't automatically directly applied to what they need to learn and what they're working on. So that was really freeing, but also very exciting, because for the apprentices, they immediately see a connection. The other thing that's a good distinction is, even within the second week, I think, of training, they at least once a week are working at neighborhood on real projects, real deadlines, real clients. And as the apprenticeship goes along, they get more and more responsibility, to the point where most of the end of the apprenticeship, they're just working in neighborhood as employees, essentially, and getting mentored and taught through actual work, which later on we can give you kind of a good example with Jamar, who's here. So this is kind of a list of hard skills, and then this next one is a list of what we call applied skills, which is kind of the, one way to say it's like kind of the secret rules of the working world, right? Things that you've probably learned because you've either had it modeled to you or someone told you, and it's kind of those things that you don't actually learn until someone says it or shows it. And so how do we develop both hard skills? Because if you can build an Excel calendar, but you don't have attention to detail, then you're screwed, basically. So you have to marry the skills. And so that's what we really try to develop. Everything we teach, hard skills, has to have a why. Why do you learn this, and for what purpose? And then the ultimate goal is to transition them from the apprenticeship. We open up our entire network of people. Anyone we know, anyone we connect to, they do a ton of informational interviews, but the idea is to transition them from their apprenticeship into the start of an actual career, not just job placement at like a basement level position where there's high turnover, but actually starting a career like someone who's out of college would start a career. Might be entry level, but there's an opportunity to actually grow a career, not just stay in the same pattern. So that's at least a kind of broad overview of the training. Not sure what's
Vince.
So I want to tell you a little bit about, so this, we've just completed our second full apprenticeship. This is Vince from our first year, and formerly homeless. He's a veteran, which is really amazing. The reason I mentioned that, because we very rarely talk about the actual specifics of someone's past, because when they get to us, they're already moving into an entirely different future. Mm-hmm. So there really isn't a need to talk that much about what's happened before. But Vince actually works as a full-time case manager for Project Home, serving homeless vets. So that's a really cool way that he's been able to incorporate not only his past, but also what he learned. Brevette. So this is Brevette. He actually works in neighborhoods. So he's worked at neighborhoods since he graduated from the apprenticeship. Very, very wild character.
It's the best style in the office.
Yeah, absolutely. But watching him and Vince interact was like, it was like a sitcom. It was ridiculous. They're like brothers, but they're totally different. And But he's doing really well. And then Salim, he went through the apprenticeship this year. He's actually, he's been a longtime painter, very good painter, not artistic painter, but like commercial and residential painter. And through what he learned in the apprenticeship, he's actually going to formalize that painting into a business. So he's starting a company. And then Jamar, who loves this picture because he loves...
Because of his smile. See, I got this laser pointer.
I'm just going to warn you. I'm going to warn you about Jamar. If he doesn't smile, it's because he's so cool under pressure. It's funny. So one of our board members is an HR head. And we have them do like interviews with her to kind of assess where they're at. And it was so funny because she came back, I talked to her after, she goes, Jamar, I mean, he's the type of guy that if like the house is burning down, he's calm. I'm like, oh, that explains why when I first started training him, he looked kind of like he may want to fight me a little bit. So that gave a good explanation, but this is the one time we caught him smiling, so...
Busted.
Yeah.
We put it everywhere now, so...
But he's been amazing. He's actually still working on some projects right now, probably through the end of the year for Neighborhood, and then I'm going to brag on him a little bit, but just an insane ability to focus, and actually, I think Ricky will speak to this a little bit, but his design instincts, I've never seen anyone pick up this quickly, coming in with really, like, minimal understanding or minimal like experience with even like various programs with computer and like moving through them so fast that so we start on Apple Pages, he like broke it in the first week. He's like building something like, this program is too slow for me. So I was like, I don't know what to do.
You're not supposed to be creative.
I'm gonna have to resource you out to someone else at this point. I'll hand over to Ricky because he's gonna show another video, but does that make sense how the apprenticeship works? Cool.
Sure, there's tons of questions, so don't worry.
I'm going to continue to brag on Jamar because the next video I want to show is a project this summer I got to direct in Brazil for Coke and the World Cup. By far, one of my most exciting experiences, but Jamar was very integral in us actually winning the job because
As some of you may know, when you're pitching for this work, you have to put together treatments and decks to basically explain your vision as a director for how you would take this concept and make it even more awesome. And so at the time, Jamar had shown a lot of interest in InDesign, Photoshop, and those types of skills. And so, you know, we decided to finally start putting that to the test, building decks. And, you know, it's, to me, it's one of the best culminations of like watching the training interact with like real life circumstances, because something I always teach out of is Coke does not care that you were formerly incarcerated or that you're an apprentice, or all they want is the best product. And to me, that that helps keep it out of the classroom, as I say, is because it's not like someday when you're in the working world, it's gonna get really intense and you're gonna have to do this. It's like, no, we were like on a conference call and he's like putting together finishing touches and I'm like, finish it now. Like, you know. And so I think particularly for me, it's helped me, I wouldn't say that I'm a teacher, but in those circumstances, I found that I really love the pressure and the intensity and the realness under which, like, if you don't get this to them, we could probably lose the job. And I think it helps keep an honesty to the experience, which Jamar can speak on. But yeah, anyway, he helped us put together the deck that ultimately won us the job, and then put together a whole slew of other stuff as far as research. When we basically had 5 days to shoot this video, you'll see, or 8 days, sorry. Whatever, it was a really short time. We had to shoot and edit all within, it was like a blitzkrieg. So we put together a very pointed research on what we would shoot where and how, and he helped me put that plan together, which ultimately helped us win the job. There it is.
Light up the world, light up the world. Run like you're born to fly.